About myself, I'm Mick Langeberg. I'm manager customer service and supply chain, or supply chain and customer service. Within our company, we don't have separate departments for process support or process improvement. Our philosophy is that line managers are also the ones improving the processes. So my second hat is that I'm a Lean Six Sigma black belt, like my colleague in operations, like my colleague in engineering. And together we always work, if everyone has a project at every time going on. So that way we keep improving the organization. But let me introduce FICO as well, because many of you might not know what we are doing. Why are you here, FICO? Many of you, when you buy a new phone, you're probably not looking for a bigger or a heavier phone. It always needs to go smaller and smaller. Same with hearing aids, medical devices. And that's why we are here, because miniaturization is no longer a choice, it's a necessity. And that's our challenge, to transform all these designs into micro-precision parts. And also to inspire the designers and the product innovators to go further than they think is possible once they get to know our technologies. And those technologies are electroforming, that's what we do in Holland. We have a second site in the UK that does chemical etching. And recently we acquired a laser technology company. Within that frame, we can cater for a lot of different desires, wishes, aspect ratios for our clients. And we're basically in everything. If you look at your average day, you will find, without you knowing it, that a lot of FICO products actually is part of that. Foods, industrial, automotive, medical, electronics, industrial printing, even in aerospace. I actually understood that recently some of our parts literally went to Mars. But we're also a company. We have amazing technology, but we're also a company with customers, lead times, production, and that's where we come in. As I said, we are a Lean Six Sigma minded company, and about 3 years ago, process mining entered our lives. We obviously got involved with Fluxicon. We did the trainings on Coursera, and we have more than a decade of Lean Six Sigma improvements. And we have, in this practice talk, I want to talk to you about our recent experience. We actually went on mining the customer journey. Just our original efforts were from inside out. Now we actually looked at how does a customer perceive FICO, and what do we need to do to make that an interesting, more pleasing way of doing business. And the results are quite astonishing to us. For us, it's critical to be first to market with new designs and applications. And we have an ambition to do that within 15 working days from the original request. So if a customer comes with something we don't know, and in 15 days he has something tangible that he can use in his prototyping. Reality was that we were far away from that. And we tried everything, and nothing succeeded to become faster than that until we learned that we need to work hand in hand with all the disciplines within FICO. So we started this project with a problem. It took too long. And we looked at how the customer would look at us. So he starts with selecting suppliers. He shares his ideas. He doesn't even know yet how the exact design has to look, but he has some ideas about tolerances, sizes, or functionality. He comes to FICO, and we provide back samples and a quotation, so he already can do a cost analysis on the project. That's how, in our minds, the journey should look like. But we didn't know how it really looked, what in practice it was. So we started to mine that journey in our data. We basically find there's a pre-stage, a sample request, and a follow-up. And there are a couple of milestones in there. The initial request comes in via call or via our web interface. Then a discussion takes place, and then you come to a specification that the customer wants. And we get truly an authorization to go ahead and make something. Then for the customer, the only thing that's relevant to us is that they get actually that box delivered to their desk so they can start their process. And obviously then a follow-up stage comes where we engage with them. Did he like the design? Did he like the tolerance? Did he like the price? How's this project in general working? And basically a yes or no to a further stage. But this information was scattered all over our IT landscape. So we started with a sample workflow system we had. We enriched it. We even looked at the emails we got from clients. So what was really the first point of contact with them? We looked at the purchase orders, track and trace data, because we were all thinking, oh, when we ship it, it's done. No, it's when it's at their desk, when our job is done. And obviously our ERP system, and we have an electronic plan board called T-cards that we also use to monitor every step in production. That's actually where we originally started our process mining efforts 3 years ago. And it was the first time we looked at a data set coming from multiple sources, and that was not completely without challenges, because we had to find a common case identifier, which was all over the place. And we had different date formats between the different systems, for instance, day-month versus month-day, and false time notations, midnight. Not everything happens at midnight in our factory. Data quality, it doesn't have a logical build-up. Did we actually produce something before we ship, to stay in very simple terms, but obviously a bit more details. And also get a unified format between all these different data sets, because Disco can handle a lot of different data sets, but also your next analytical tools, you need to make sure that the data set is ready to take them on. To give you an example, common case identifier, these are three of the data sets we use. This is basically the sample request workflow. It's kind of, let's say, over everything. Then we have sales order data, and we have production order data. And you can see here, you have a production order number, you have a part number, you have a sales order number. And we were looking at, okay, what's now the commonality? We found part number, because each different sample has different specifications, so they get, even at early stage, they get a different part number. But was it somewhere in the order files? Because the part number could be a nice way to do that. Yes, we found it in the sales order data. And yes, we also found it in the workflow. So we decided part number will be the common case identifier, because we do a part once. If we do a new revision with new specs, it will become a new part number. Also, date and time notations. I just mentioned day and month and day. But also, if you look at, for instance, here, different than here and different than here. In the production order, in the original file, we saw a date and we saw a false time notation, midnight. In the sales order, we saw actually the real true time when it was entered into the system, so 9:15 at this date. In the sample request work order flow, we just saw a date and no time at all. So that's definitely different, and you need to match them all up in one data set. Just to give you an example about those false time notations and what it does. Over here, you can see a short file. The steps are not in logical sequence, but you can see by the dates and the times that if you import it into Disco, it'll put it in the logical sequence of how they actually happens. Now imagine that same data set, but with everything has a midnight. Disco doesn't know, so it can't apply that logic, so it will come in the wrong sequence. And we saw that obviously with the production order system. So especially when you have multiple activities on one day, because if every activity is one day after the order, you wouldn't have that problem. And once your resolution goes to the hours, you do. We were lucky. We found in our production order database, we found a separate column that actually had the timing, so we can actually merge them into the data set. That one already had it. It was logical, because when you enter an order, you do a price check, you do a confirmation, that all happens in, I don't know, minutes, maybe hours after each other. The sample request workflow was really like a milestone planning, and we saw that rarely or actually never in our samples happened that it was on the same day. So for there, we could live without the hour notation. And there we came to a first process mining. This is the high level. Obviously, when you open it up, you get a spaghetti like we've seen earlier today. But we did a comprehensive one, actually one we could present to management to show them where the timelines were and where the improvement could be. the first contact to the actual sample request.
So in 1 day, 2 days.
Then when we get the actual order to make the sample, on average 52 days. Remember the ambition of 15 days. And then it gets delivered to the client, and then you get a follow-up. And we're mainly dependent on the client. They have to do their testing, their analysis. So it's relatively okay that that takes a little bit longer. So when we opened up this step of the actual realization of the sample, and this is where we typically bridge between process mining and traditional Lean Six Sigma tooling, you could see that if you take the medians in the quartiles, somewhere between 29 and 76 days, we took about a sample. So if a client comes, I want something completely new, can you guarantee me a day? I can say, probably there. Well, the expectation was 15. So you can imagine that we were far away from our ambition, and we wanted to improve that. The whole our leadership team, but also the company, found this not to be acceptable. Like I said, it's not the first year we started with process mining. We did some pretty amazing lead time reductions in our regular production process, but they were clearly not working for samples. And if just to give an idea, this is where our client's process is. They do a concept, they do a prototyping, and then they go into mass production in a couple of steps. And where we traditionally are is there. Once they have a developed prototype, they plan orders to FICO, we produce them, we ship to them, and that's how the process works. And that works very fine. If you look at that type of the that part of the business, very very pleasing customers. But we found, when we started analyzing, we found about 50 differences between sample orders and regular production orders. And in the next slides, I will tell you a bit more about the dominant factors. But just to give you a bit of an idea, we had one group that had a lead time twice as long as any other sample. They all used the same type of equipment. I'll tell you a little bit more what lithography is. Every time there were new designs, every time you need to make card drawings, routings, trials needed to be made. Engineering had to get involved to do, I would say, different things with existing equipment to come to the result we wanted. Complex routings, far more complex than an already optimized production process. But we also found out that although we all thought they were important, they didn't go any faster in production than normal. Only the ones that we did give priority treatment did. So we started mining again, and what you can see here is, on the right, this is our regular productions, and these are our sample productions, just to see where the differences are. We saw two things. A group called precision parts, I'll tell you in the next slides a bit more. And the other one was a specific piece of equipment that was causing a bottleneck. Precision parts, now what are these? Basically, it's a group name for free-form parts. If you look at these, people say, well, it looks like a high-tech toothpick. It's actually part of a contactor. But the next one could be completely different in design. If you looked at all the other types of samples we did for inkjets, filtration, we saw that typically those had 50 days lead time, this one had 100 days, twice as long. That was unusual for us. Remarkable. And then we had a new type of equipment called Laser Direct. You can see that as a printer. It already prints the design directly onto the product. Well, in the past, we used glass mask or film tooling to do that. So this is supposed to be more efficient and flexible. But again, almost twice as long as standard lithography. So we had a lot of findings, but we couldn't still it didn't tell us anything about how to improve, so you could best describe it as a piece of a puzzle. So one holds the ear, says it's a sail, the other one points at the slagtand and says, hey, it's narrow. That's how we were. We couldn't figure it out from the data what it was, so we called into the business and just started to share our findings with them to get these pieces of the puzzle together, because we knew what we traditionally did, and we saw all this, and it just didn't make sense to us yet. And while we were talking, we actually noted that all these different sample orders we were talking about had a completely different role within the customer cycle. It was actually in the prototyping phase, completely new from the ID phase to something tangible. And we also saw that a couple of additional steps were attached to those orders internally with us. Traditionally, we were here and not there. So the customer was actually wanting something different from us than we expected. And we called this flow engineer to order, because they want new specifications each time they place an order to us. It's not one time and then 100 times the same. Each time it will be different. It's a critical element because they're prototyping. So if our component is holding them up, we hold up their whole entire project. So if they're important to our customer, they also need to be important to us. And we need to prioritize these in the organization above anything else. And also, we needed a lot of engineering and development in that same cycle. We couldn't wait for a month for an engineer to become available to look at it. It had to be done right now. So we found three dominant factors, and we executed the pilot in 4 weeks. The priority setting, we decided that samples take priority over anything. Anybody that gets a sample at their work center or their desk, that's the first thing they look at. We made them very visible, because how do I recognize a sample if I do 100 orders on a day? So we earmarked those. And the data. We needed to make sure that the data was at the work center before the actual product was there, so people could actually prepare themselves for the work, because it was typically different than normal, so it helps if you can prepare yourself. And that working in sequence is what I always told them. What comes in first must go out first, and then the second comes in, and then that comes in. Literally, we use in prom the X dotted bar chart to prove if people were working in sequence. And now we're going to tell them something different. We know we have a stack of work. Now a sample comes in, you drop everything, and you do the sample first, and then you get on with your normal. So we asked them to prioritize over anything else. And that was fundamentally different than we always told them to do. So people had a lot of fear also that our existing orders would be impacted by this, this way of working. And also a fear that if that happened, they would get the blame for that. So we talked to our leadership team, and they convinced all the operators and the team leaders that within this pilot it was okay if that happened, because we just wanted to test out the impact of it. And we keep repeating that in every briefing and message we have, because this is a difficult habit to change for people. Until we were convinced that everybody learned and lived it. So we did a pilot, and then obviously people say, okay, yeah, what about that on-time performance versus that sample speed? Because we told you it wasn't going to work. So here's the sample lead time. You remember that chart? So this is where it was before we improved. You can see literally up to 100 days, and this is the line of 15 days. You can see that hardly ever we made that. We piloted, and almost immediately we dropped below that 15 days. There were 2 points outside that, and there were really valid points, there were really real causes for that. So you could just see the effect of what we experimented with. We also saw that if you look at the late orders per root cause, that sample priority was maybe one in 4 weeks' time versus all the other elements. So it didn't have any big impact on time performance as well. So it was for us safe to say that the performance improved dramatically, while the on-time delivery of existing orders was hardly or not affected. And we got clearance from that point of to implement this company-wide. So we maintained the sample priority up till today. We started last year, September. Every day, everybody now, it's a habit. If you have a sample, it's marked as a sample. It's the first thing you do. You don't think about it. It's logical to people now. We have coordination throughout the day. You can imagine if you have a sample that takes 70 days, people tend to do once a week a meeting, discuss a status. No, we do it twice a day, every morning and every afternoon. And we literally micromanage those samples through the process. We do info sharing. Just to give you a bit of an example, we have a design over here. After we produce, we have to measure if the actual product meets the design in the design specs. What we do now is when that drawing is made, it goes to metrology. So metrology has it 1 or 2 days before the product actually comes there. So they can do all their setup and preparations in advance. Even in the system, we tag the sample orders. Why? Because once we improve, we know the next thing was going to come. So we drive continuous improvement by measuring weekly and root causing all the late orders, and from there address the next improvements in similar ways as the last presentation with the plan, do, check, act cycle. So how would I summarize our experience? I think what made this project important was there was a collective need for speed. We all saw we were missing business. We were missing out on business because of this. Just imagine you're a supplier or a customer. You do a request to 5 suppliers. The first 2 come back within a day, and the third one comes back in 2 weeks. You already started engaging with this first 2, and you're already on the journey with them, and the third one is not going to be important to you again. So we started with the customer journey in our minds to define where we needed to improve. And then we did a lot of hypothesis testing, and we just revealed pieces of the puzzle, but they were just pieces of the puzzle. It was a reflection of reality, not actual reality. And then we leveraged the data with human process knowledge from the business owners and discovered our engineer-to-order process. Just imagine that you don't know you have this, and then you discover it, and then you know how to address it. So we designed the pilot, got a leadership team involved. It was literally jaw-dropping. We never expected to come to 15 days if you come from 70 days. It just happened basically overnight. So after we mined that customer journey, we started to consistently grow new business at an accelerated speed. That's it. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Mick. So we have time for questions. As before, please raise your arms. I'll start off. You mentioned when we were preparing the talk that it is like a new process that was discovered that people didn't think about. So can you maybe talk a little bit about that kind of shift, or at what point in time in this project did it start? How did it start, and when did you realize, oh, actually, this is a separate process that we really should look at differently?
Yeah, but actually when we started to put all those pieces of the puzzle together on one table with the business owners, we started talking, and you get their stories. Yeah, it's always new. And this client, because traditionally you do it once, you set up this design, and then let's say for a couple of years, you sell that product to them. No, these are customers that actually want new designs every time. And then you also, and it's very hard. Of course, I have to work with him and him and him, and he has another priority than me. And so we started talking, okay, so there are customers that really have on a repetitive base continuously new products. And why is that? Because you would think somebody develops something and then he sells it on freezer. Yeah, because their products are each time are different. Okay, so you continually start to engineer to those new products. And typically because what I said in the earlier, ambition is to push boundaries. So those are typically the products that are actually pushing the boundaries. So we also need engineering involved in this is what equipment can do today within industrialized parameters. Now we ask you to do something completely different with the equipment to get to the specification the customer wants. And once the customer likes that, by the way, I want you to paradigmize that new way of working again so we can repeat it 100 times a month. So.
Yes. Okay, great. Okay. Thank you. So where's the first question?
I will ask the first question. You were talking about that for the sample process, you reduced lead time for the customer, right? So what I was actually wondering, does this lead in some kind of a way, or did you measure it? What kind of impact it has of samples going into production? Did that increase, for instance?
Yes, we saw literally when we started, the list was long because we had a lot of samples on, but we could see that 1 or 2 samples came on every fortnight. At this moment, we have about a run rate of about 5 to 15 samples per week that come in as new requests. And I said it at the end, I think this is the first year that we actually hit our budget targets for new business development. So that's all signs that, let's say, the speed has an appealing attraction to it from the customers towards us.
And does this also mean that customers who get their samples faster are more eager to choose for Avico as a company to do their production with? I'd imagine that would like give you the bigger deals for like the, when you do production, it will give more benefit than only doing a sample, right?
Yeah, it's a confidence builder. I think that's what you're asking because we can do this in 15 days, and we know. We can do the standard product production process also in 15 days, but it's basically easier because by that time you already have all the parameters and all the work instructions, etc., and the equipment set up ready. So it's easier than when you have to start from scratch, develop that, and still do it in 15 days. Yeah, it's basically a different. We discovered it's a different flow in the business, so you have to handle it differently.
Thanks.
Okay. Yes. Other so questions for Mick? Sorry.
So I've got a question to your event data you used. You said that you implement, so you use data from several databases.
Correct.
So were there also emails you scanned, or and how did you do that? Because not in every email or in every document you have, you've got a case ID, this product number. So how can you sort it to this case then?
Yeah, that was actually a good point. That was the hardest work in the data collection to get the email communication in there. We heard similar question earlier today. One of the things we're doing now, we're working on our next project. We also want to see if we can mine our email transaction logs, for instance, anything that's from a specific customer, so at customername.com, how many emails came towards us, to whom, who responded, which timelines, also to get a grip on subjects and emails, and because that's obviously where you come more in the text mining type of arena.
Yeah.
We found that the further we reach out to the customers and original responses, the more information it gives us about our process and where it stands. So it was hard the first time. We literally did it manually. Rather not do it again, but we're now looking at ways how we can query that out of our email server.
Okay, so of course you've got the know-how of an IT specialist to do that.
It's in the running discussion at the moment how to do it. Also to be, also if you look at confidentiality of emails and data, this is definitely a topic. We haven't figured it out yet, but we're trying to solve that puzzle.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, more questions for Nick, for Mick, sorry. Okay.
Thank you for your impressive speech.
Thank you.
Question, do you expect there to be a limit where you can keep prioritizing samples?
Yes, there is a limit to that. I think this works as long as it's a certain volume. One of our things we found out, in the last months, we got this project closed and it was running business. We found that if you don't do the next step to industrialization of these type of customers, then you run into problems. So that actually engineering got involved in not only making beautiful parts. I know since I worked there, I think that's beautiful, but...
Yeah.
but also, how now to make sure that we can do it 1,000 times without your involvement?
Exactly.
So we also had to work on the next step, how to pass it on to industrialization.
Okay. And then maybe even increase the capacity in the future.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. We literally are this moment at the tipping point from a 3 shifts, so 5 days operation, to certain points already in the 7 days.
Great. Thanks.
Thanks for the presentation. What I wanted to ask is, have you considered using, for instance, I guess you work with SolidWorks or CATIA or whatever, using internal software packages and the logs of the internal software packages to combine them later on with the error logs of the CNC or etching machines to to trace correlations between design parameters and errors later on in the machines?
Good question. Yes, in the background, we're actually literally working on combining machine I/O sensoric data with chemistry data, temperatures, batch sizes. Actually, at the background, that's more one of the other projects where we internally basically create a data lake so we can analyze products that had a good quality, what were the parameters versus the ones that were below expectations. So yeah, that's, it's a different project, but and it's definitely done outside. It is a data mining, but it's still not in the early stages of collecting.
Thanks.
More questions? Okay, one more.
So I have quite a short question. When you conduct the pilot project or something, people tend to work more effectively on the case. Have you, and the figures that you've shown are quite impressive, I mean the result figures. I wonder if you have checked whether the people tended to work more effective on this pilot project, and if you have cleared your final data from that kind of effect.
I'm sorry, I'm not completely getting it.
I mean, when you test something, people who are a part of this test procedure, they tend to work more effectively because they are under focus of their management. And this causes the misleading data, quite a big effect. And in fact, this effect is not maybe not a cause of real improvement, but because people tend to work better. Have you checked that kind of issue in your research?
I think the good thing is that many people are involved in this process, or even if you or me would work more effectively in our part of the chain, the overall chain wouldn't be heavily improved. And I think the fact because we really took when it was at the customer from where their initial request came from, basically the start and end point were outside our ability to control. So I think that helps. Priority does help. I think that you just need to decide as a company which level of priorities you take for what. Up in this moment, samples are still a daily topic that you, if you walk around production or in offices, people talk about samples. While, say, a year ago, hardly everyone talked about samples, and when they talked, it was in a negative way because it was difficult, it was not standard, and just blocked our lead time performance, basically. So, hope that helps answering your question.
Yeah.
Maybe so. I think I have one last question that maybe is a little bit related to the previous question, because as far as I understood, it's not in the pilot phase anymore, right? You did a pilot, you saw that it was effective, and since September, it's now in productive use. And you also talked about that now it's like second nature, so people don't think about it anymore. And you talked about how counterintuitive it was to get there. So I was wondering, so what did you find was the hardest thing to actually get people to this, that they're now not thinking about it anymore, that samples are the number one priority, but you know, how to overcome.
Yeah, overcome that.
Yes.
I think it's probably being positive about it, giving compliments, positive inquiry about, okay, this was really good. We literally yesterday had a customer on our floor expressing his gratitude for a couple of high-end samples we made for him, which basically saved his complete prototyping. He went to market faster because of us. That type of feedback helps a lot to people. That becomes, obviously, there's data, but it is also the mindset helps a lot with people. So you stay positive about the good things.
Yes.
I think that's a key one. People, if they fear or feel unsafe, will start behaving in counterproductive ways than you want to.
Yeah, great. Well, thanks a lot. Let's thank Mick once more.